They started building during the 60s, in that decade of high density and high optimism. Bransholme has more than 10,000 council houses, a population of 30,000, and a lot of grass. The community spirit struggles to survive. Many hearts belong to happier days and a different way of life. Most Bransholme folk were rehoused from the old back streets off the Hessel Road. It was here that Hull's once thriving community of trawlermen and their families lived before the onslaught of slum clearance. Ironically, the demolition of their homes coincided with the beginning of the end of their industry and the way of life that went with it. Instead, there's Bransholme. For the first time in their lives, there were gardens and garages, indoor lavatories, proper bathrooms and central heating. But the houses were designed in such a way that the fronts were indistinguishable from the backs. And the little streets where no traffic thundered by were called closes and garths.
I've worked on this estate for 5.5 years. And I mean, I'm not known to be an ace navigator, but nevertheless, I still cannot find my way into these closes. Whoever actually thought up the street order, I think was either a genius or incredibly complicated mind. To view it as an estate is a mistake, because it's a town, really. Apparently, it's the largest local authority housing estate in Europe. But essentially, it's got the facilities of an estate, which causes a number of problems.
Places like Bransholme have become Britain's own third world, with high unemployment, bored and alienated youngsters, a rising crime rate, poverty and domestic violence. Litter bins are constantly being stolen or vandalised. ...26.5% are unemployed, double the national average. That's one in four on the dole. The local post office opens half an hour early at 8:30 to cope with the queues for state benefits of one kind or another. When the planners first penciled in the Bransholme scheme in the 50s, mass unemployment was simply a part of pre-war history. The consumer society was taking off and modern homes with all mod cons were everyone's dream. Bransholme offered all this, plus fresh air and wide open spaces. But times changed, and so did Bransholme.
Bransholme is such a large estate, and it seems to be a fact that the higher the density, the lower the resourcing. All the factors that you can expect, unemployment, domestic violence, therefore the number of divorces, there is simply an increase in all our work from whatever source. And therefore this estate really, the more one thinks about it, the more one considers that it has to be the size more than anything else. Many people leave the estate in order to go to work. They leave the estate to go to the theatre. They leave the estate for entertainment and for leisure reasons. And trapped, therefore, on this estate are the people without sufficient money, namely those people who are on benefits and who therefore have to find all their resources here in this community. They then become very lonely, very isolated, very much in debt. And the whole thing becomes a spiral problem.
Paul Wilson is one of Bransholme's unemployed. He's 22, was brought up on the estate, and he's never had what he calls a proper job. He's kept afloat by state benefits, which compete with the wages on display at the job centre.
I go into the job centre 3 and 4 times a week. But to no avail, no job. It's actually take me off the dole and pay for my own rent. Paying for my own rates. Electricity, food, clothing, washing materials. That's a hell of a lot to take on. So it'd have to be a good wage.
On a pylon 30 feet high, a heart fashioned out of steel is Bransholme's welcoming symbol, erected by private developers who built the main shopping centre. Unlike some parts of Bransholme, it's clean, well-kept and a magnet for Paul and his friends. It's also the only place on the estate with seats for the general public. Since there's nowhere else for people to congregate, this tends to be a meeting point for young and old alike. Paul and his pals spend a lot of time hanging around here, engaged in a kind of friendly war with the ever-present private police force.
The reason the movers on being is they say, could you circulate, give the old folk a chance? But there's never no old, there is old folk going there, don't get me wrong. But there's enough seats in there. It's just an excuse to movers, because they think we're littering the place up. But there's not to do outside.
If you haven't that many bus fares out, I could have been a rich man by now. But sometimes the bus is overwhelmed.
We've sometimes used them during interviews with the police to allow the child to be able to explain to the police what's been happening.
It's a sign of the times that all the big housing estates in Hull have their own teams of social workers.
There might be enough here. I mean, you never know until you get involved in it. What else?
The Bransholme Task Force is the biggest, with a total of 20 social workers plus backup staff. They deal with a caseload involving every kind of domestic misfortune, from juvenile delinquency to loneliness amongst the elderly. They're divided into 4 teams serving different parts of the estate.
Well, I work on sort of the older part of the estate that covers the shopping centre, which is just here, and the maisonettes, which are ahead. And that's really the middle slice of the estate. On the left, you've got West Bransholme, and also further on, a private estate called Sutton Park. Now, by and large, this area is the more stable part of the community because it's been settled longer. There's also quite a few elderly people living around the centre. One of the things that we do find, the move up here, often from West Hull, and it's miles away from anywhere familiar, people that they know, places that they know, and they never really settle. They often don't, in a sense, fully unpack. You know, ornaments never get put back on mantelpieces or pictures on walls, and they become quite lonely and isolated.
Marge Green is a 62-year-old spinster who came to Bransholme 16 years ago, but who, in a manner of speaking, has never unpacked. Any day, she's expecting to hear from the council that she's been allocated a house back on her old stamping ground down the Hessel Road.
I just can't stand it. I've hated Bransholme ever since the day I put my foot in it. I never liked it. When I'm down Hessel Road, I'm happy. But to come back here, I'm utterly depressed.
Why?
It's the surroundings. I mean, you get kids footballing outside your back kitchen window. You can't sit and have your meal in peace. It's either banging at the door, banging at the window, or climbing over the fence. It's just sheer hell living here.
Every week, Marge makes the 30-minute bus journey back to the hustle and bustle of the world she understands.
You enjoy yourself quite a bit. She said, why,
funny. I got the sandwiches made.
You go down Nesra Road and you meet the people on Nesra Road, they've got hats as big as gold. Dolly Glenton, opposite Liverpool Street, Wet Fish Shop, Mr. Maltby at corner of Liverpool Street. Too numerous to talk about, really, but you go in one shop, you got back down here, no. Oh, God, I wish to God you would, you know. Because you talk about the old times. I mean, those old ones get together. When I go down in morning, I'm going down into Gordon Street, to our Thora's. And it's just a big one laugh when you go down there. You go into butchers, all the butchers know me down there. No, it's like a real close-knit community.
Yeah, throw off my wife.
Bye.
And I come back and I never see a living soul. And be from one Thursday to the next and not see a living soul.
In homes where parents are unemployed, discipline can often break down, leaving the kids very much to their own devices. On Bransholme, gangs of young boys can be seen on the streets wreaking their own brand of mischief and mayhem. No public amenity is safe. But these are the more visible problems.
People go on, for example, about drugs and about glue sniffing and so on. I mean, our impression, our feeling is that that isn't as much of an issue as one might expect on an estate like this, although there certainly is a problem, probably that will grow in time. But we think alcohol is a problem.
When they built the houses, they built the pubs. It's a familiar, friendly atmosphere if you've got the money. Many on Bransholme haven't got the price of a pint. Outside, it's a bleak and uninviting prospect. Bransholme has more than its fair share of crime. Theft, burglary, assault, often committed by young men without the money for a pint.
You can go in pub a few nights a week, you know what I mean? A few bob, you know what I mean? But what I'm saying is, if you want to do more, you've got to get a job, or you've got to go out and rob and get it. You know what I mean?
Go out and rob and get it?
Yeah. Because there's no else better to do anyway, is there?
How many of you have been involved in crime of one kind or another?
All of us.
What were you been doing what?
Shoplifting. Burglary. You name it.
Name it.
Assaults.
Why do you do that?
It's a vicious estate, right? You get bored, you know what I mean? Get out of your head. You get yourself into trouble and start fighting, you know what I mean? They come and fight you up, don't they?
Piss them to, won't
you? Get back at the police for what they're doing to you. Start from you, don't you? Get back at them.
I mean, there is nothing else really for kids to do other than gravitate around pubs, stand on street corners. We have one or two excellent youth facilities, but not enough. If you think of Bridlington without cinemas, employers, factories, you know, all the usual sorts of things that you would expect if you went into a town, that's Bransholme.
Just after 8:30 in the morning and already half the queue has been paid out. For most of them, it's the most pressing engagement of the day, so they come early.
Thank you.
Old age pensions, family allowances, supplementary benefits for those below the poverty line. In addition, more than 6,000 households receive housing benefit in the form of rent and rate rebates. That's more than two-thirds of council tenants. Double the national figure. Bransholme is a subsistence level estate. In this street, every family is out of work with the exception of the tenant in the end house. But he's leaving now because as the only employed person in the street, life became intolerable. Today he's clearing up prior to moving out. Stephen John, a self-employed insurance agent, being driven from his home by less well-off fellow residents.
I've had the windscreen of my car smashed, four tyres slashed, a bottle filled with, we think it was battery acid, thrown through the lounge window while we sat watching TV. We've been burgled whilst we were in the process of moving. There's been a few other items. 999 calls to the police, informing them that there was something wrong at the house. And of course, when the police turn up, there's nothing here. We've had the drains in the rear garden, the covers were smashed, the fence was ripped down. I've had brake fluid poured all over my car to try and do damage to the paintwork. Fortunately, it didn't. And that basically, you know, apart from abuse and threats and dogs going to be set on me if I go outside and don't go out on your own at night, basically that's it.
Settled since then in a different house on Bransholme, Stephen and his wife Roz intend to leave the estate altogether and buy a place of their own. But for the time being, they're glad to be away from their previous home.
It is quite a relief to have got out of that house into this one, yes. But I think it was worse for Roz than me, because she was left on her own all day, wouldn't it?
It's terrible. There's a barrier there. I don't know whether it's because we're working and people we were living near were unemployed. We seemed like the odd couple on, you know, on the block where we lived. I was really happy on the Bransholme estate. But my opinion is I think things have deteriorated.
But it isn't all bad news. Many Bransholme residents like it here, and about 500 tenants, that's 5%, are buying their homes. They're proud of their owner-occupier status, and some declare it without equivocation. Other owners change the front door, build extensions, put on new paint, anything to separate themselves from the surrounding uniformity. And of course, it doesn't take a mortgage to have a pretty garden.
The houses are nice houses. I mean, they were built at a time when the idea was to give, you know, working people a through lounge, downstairs cloak, and all the rest of it. The problem is fuel's become more expensive since the houses were built. Unemployment has risen, so through lounges mean large carpets, picture windows mean large curtains. Expensive fuel means that if your electricity or gas is disconnected, you haven't even got a fireplace to burn two sticks in. So the sort of poverty that takes place in houses once your essential services goes, it's actually quite appalling at times.
Well, you dare put your heating on because the electric bills are enormous. I mean, I've got one still to pay, £314.49, and I don't intend paying it because it's impossible, I just can't. I want a coal fire.
The most underprivileged part of the estate is this block of maisonette flats, nicknamed Alcatraz, a council dumping ground for problem families and their problems. There's been one murder and a manslaughter here, as well as outbreaks of arson.
I think everybody's recognised that they're a very problematic piece of building, and the decision has already been taken to renovate some of them and demolish others, because they're not particularly popular housing units. Quite often a sort of ghetto type situation gets created there. Nevertheless, there's a tenants association, a residents group there, that's quite keen to improve conditions.
Paul Wilson, alone and out of work, is one of the many young single people allocated three-bedroom flats in this deeply despised block.
I need a job now, really, for this big house, because I'm going to get some incredible bills in. Not now, it's summer, granted, but winter. There's damp, there's the draft. It's cold. Obviously, I'm going to really up that electricity heating, and I'm going to get a big bill, aren't I? Stands to reason. So, obviously, I need a job. It's ridiculous. Giving me a three-bedroom.
One third of Bransholme's 10,000 council tenants are behind with the rent. Another third have their rents paid by the DHSS. Paul is one of them. Attacks on property are a serious problem. Prefabricated shops, hastily put up in the face of protests about lack of facilities, have been popular targets. Some traders have been broken into and vandalised often enough for them to call it a day. Bransholme's one of those places where insurance against burglary costs more. There are parts of the estate which help to explain its local reputation as a trouble spot in the middle of nowhere. Respectable residents are concerned about its image. Those who've been in trouble with the police blame local conditions.
There's lots of violence and burglaries and robberies on this estate due to the fact that people just don't have anything to do around here. The estate itself is depressing, really. The living conditions are depressing. Lots of things are depressing. That's why a lot of people do what they do.
But there are some very nice houses.
There are some nice houses, yeah, but a lot of the younger people cannot get those houses. We're just throwing these houses, these maisonettes, and things like that.
It's not really what to know to do, is it, really? I mean, there's only two youth clubs, and then they won't take you in because you're too old. So, where do you put yourself?
Old-timers put a brave face on things, but Bransholme lacks people with experience of community leadership, and various attempts to get things going arouse little interest.
I get quite cross, really, when people talk about there are all these opportunities and people are apathetic, they won't take them up. I mean, I don't know if I'm right, but if you think about sort of towns in Victorian times growing up, they grew around something like a mill, or there was a reason for people to be there. The only reason why people are here is because the houses are here, and somehow or other you've got to create bonds and links between people, and that doesn't happen overnight. It actually takes a lot of time. I'm astonished, in fact, that people have started things and are doing things off their own bat, because it's actually quite a thankless task. And there are all sorts of excellent people about, lots of possibilities, the beginnings of things that are happening. I'm quite hopeful, actually. There's a lot of potential on this estate.
The local council's just received extra government cash to improve facilities. One shopping parade's to be replaced by a proper centre, and there's to be a new school. Also in the pipeline is a much-needed social club. But Bransholme's future needs go much deeper. That heart, symbolising Bransholme's community spirit, now has a more steely look. With so many people out of work, and with all the related problems of poverty, crime and neglect, Bransholme sometimes looks like a place under siege. In a way, it is. In a country divided by economic extremes, Bransholme is stuck at the wrong end of the spectrum. A social security colony feeling abandoned and imprisoned by hardship.
On its own, the number 8. On its own, the number 2. 3 and 9, 39.
Bransholme's other numbers game adds up to a depressing picture. 25% out of work, a third of the 10,000 council tenants in arrears with rent, and two-thirds of families in receipt of housing benefits.
704, 74, 70, 709, 70, 703, 73.
The chasm is not simply between the haves and have-nots. There's a growing resentment amongst the youth over the values of their parents who have better times to remember and who had a life before Bransholme.
I blame the older generation, me, for making it like this. That's who I blame. I'd like a job and things, money, to get me house together, and then I might think about settling down with my girlfriend, but until that time arises, I won't. My life is boring. It is boring. But I get by, I survive.
We've said the same thing about multi-stories, haven't we? We won't put families in multi-stories anymore, and that's fair enough. But you can't, I mean, this place is built now, people live here. You can't just sort of wipe it out and say it was a mistake. There's lots of things that actually could be done to stimulate and improve the quality of life, or if you like, to extend the opportunities that people have here. And I think really it's a bit of a mistake just to dismiss whole areas like this and say that there's, you know, nothing positive or no growth here.